Discord cloud. Okay. Hello. And now I'm going to go ahead and share my screen here. Make sure everybody can see it. All right. So if you are here to learn a little bit more about the European Dairy Science Education Abroad program, you are in the correct place. If not, Nicole, maybe you just want to hear about it anyway. But we are going to talk a little bit about this program today. What kind of the itinerary is going to entail. And then towards the end, my side is going to be more of the boring side, right? What does it look like to apply? How can you find scholarships if that's something that you are interested in or something that you need? The passport situation, how to apply for a passport and ways to follow up on that. We'll get to all that towards the end of the presentation, but you already got the notice, but we're recording this. I'm going to take the recording and post it to our YouTube channel so that students can watch this at any point after today. So, Nicole, I'd love for you to chat with all your friends after this info session and send them this really fun link so they can learn about the program too after today. But to get things started, my name is Ryan Vonderhaar. I work here within the college as the Global Education Coordinator, which means I get to work with the terrific resident directors made up of the faculty and staff that we have here within the college that put on our terrific education abroad programming. And today we have two of those resident directors joining us. They are going to be co-leading the European Dairy Science Program in 2022. So Dr. Winter and Dr. Pimpek, maybe you'd like to just introduce yourselves a little bit.
Yeah, so I'll go. It's weird because I can't see myself talking, but I assume it's working. So
I can see it. Yeah,
it's strange. So hello to Nicole. I think you've got me in class, and I think actually you've transferred over into advising too. So welcome. But for anybody who's watching this later on, I teach within animal sciences. I used to be a dairy nutritionist for a short amount of time. And so now I teach animal nutrition, the 3130 in the fall, and also small ruminant production in the spring and a few other courses that are kind of splattered in there depending on need. In 2008, dating myself, I received a scholarship to go study abroad, and I spent a semester in the Netherlands. So I'm excited to be co-leading this with Dr. Pimpek, and looking forward to making a return trip over there and maybe sharing some of my love for the area.
All right. Hi, Nicole. I don't think we've had the pleasure of meeting yet. Maybe if you had your video on, I could put a face to the name. But in case we haven't met, I'm Jess Pimpek, and I'm also an assistant professor in the Department of Animal Sciences. So I do a little bit of everything in this role. I teach animal welfare and behavior in fall semester. And what else do I teach? I lead the animal welfare judging team, which hopefully that'll become a course in the next couple of years. And then I do a lot of extension and outreach and research. So my background and training and passion is in animal welfare and behavior. So Dr. Winter and I actually did our PhDs together, both focused in the dairy industry. So I think we'll complement each other very nicely. I actually haven't been to the Netherlands, so I am going to learn as well. But I had the opportunity to, as a student, take part in at least three or four study abroads, and also had the opportunity to take courses in other universities as well. So I have a bit of travel background, but just never made it to the Netherlands yet. So really looking forward to this. I think that's a little bit about me.
Jess, you and I practically shared a desk for a couple of years.
We were literally like joint at the hip almost. So I think it'll be a lot of fun.
Love it. So to get things started, Dr. Winter has included some of his own pictures, but also just some of the highlights of what the itinerary we're hoping is going to look like for the 2022 program. So I'm going to just kind of key along on the slideshow here. But yeah, Dr. Winter, I'll let you kind of take it away.
Yeah, sure. My wife challenged me. She said I couldn't find a dozen educational photos from my trip. So I had to challenge her back. Actually, luckily, a lot of my friends took pictures too. So you might see some of my friends in some of these. But just to kind of talk you through the itinerary and add in maybe some personal notes. We fly into Amsterdam. That's the largest city, maybe not by population, but kind of the primary place a lot of your flights are going to go in and out of. Known for a lot of canals and waterways. I think we've tried to line up a couple of tours, especially the Anne Frank House, and working that into to Amsterdam, as well as a trip around to see some of the markets. So some of the market squares are really fun to look at. That's one of those down in the bottom right. Pretty much see anything sold there, but I always think about when I go to these markets, all of the floral products. So cheeses and flowers pretty much everywhere you go being sold, and just really pretty and aesthetically pleasing to walk around and see that. That's a pretty big piece of the industry. I even remember when we flew into Amsterdam, seeing all the greenhouses laid out. You can see them from the plane when you come in, the amount of agriculture that's maybe not necessarily conventional. And I think that's kind of a big thing when you think about the Netherlands. Historically, they kind of had the rise to power before England. Actually, the Orange royal family in England came from the Netherlands. The royal color in the Netherlands is orange. And they had their rise and then their kind of their fall as France and England took over in the mid 1700s. We think now about the Netherlands, and we think a lot about water, and we think about how they had to pump all the water out to kind of dry the land and double their land space for agriculture. And because of the water, then we spend a lot of time thinking about water quality, water safety, even dikes and dams and flooding. And then there's a good bit of agriculture. Actually, this is a pretty big dairy producing country, for example. And so this is one of the models for sustainability in the future of agriculture. So what I think is really exciting about going back there now, years into being a professor and taking students back, is to try to share that perspective and reflect myself on the advances in sustainability in this country and how we can apply those, you know, back here, our own degrees in agriculture in Ohio eventually. The Netherlands is a pretty small country, but they're really productive, and bicycles everywhere, as you can tell. So we go from Amsterdam. I don't know if I've got them all kind of in order. We will probably try to catch the Keukenhof pretty early because they close, I think, 2 days into our trip. But this is just an absolutely gorgeous garden area. Keukenhof translates roughly to kitchen patio, sort of. It's not really a kitchen house, but that's kind of the idea. The whole area around there, they actually farm tulips, right? So if we buy tulips and we put them in our gardens, they're being farmed out there in these strips. So everywhere you go, you see all these tulips in farming, and hopefully we'll see that. There's not very many places in the United States you could see that. You could go to Holland, Michigan for their tulip festival in late April and see something very similar. So we'll be coming season over there and catch these gardens at their peak beauty. From there, I think we kind of go maybe northeast. And so fietsen is actually the word for bicycling, casually bicycling. There's two different words, but casually bicycling. So I think the bottom left is actually the study abroad group from 2012, maybe. Jess, you might recognize some people on there. I know I saw Joey Brown in there. That's my bike I bought on the bottom right. One of my favorite pictures of biking into the sunset. Actually, I used to use that in a lot of just random presentations on a thank you slide. And I don't think we'll see any snow. I do actually think that was a picture in March or April. It doesn't snow there as much as it probably snows here in Ohio. But, you know, I think a lot of times, and we were talking about this too, that suddenly you look at the itinerary and go, oh, crap, we're going to go biking a couple times. And I'm not very good on a bike. I'm not going to really enjoy that day, but this is very casual biking.
We will step go slow.
Say that again, Jess.
Said, we will go slow. So don't let him deter.
Yeah. No racing unless you want to put money on it. Don't bet against me on a bike. I'll put it that way. I bike a few thousand miles a year. But we'll try to get out on the islands up there in the northern part of the country. I think we were looking at potentially a horse dairy that may be up that direction as well. And there's a university campus and a research center. But the highlight, at least for me, something I haven't seen before, is getting out onto those Frisian islands on the water. So we'll take a ferry and tour around out there and see some of those farms that are placed out there on the islands and sort of in the wind a bit. Let's see what we got next. So then we kind of cycled down through the western part of the country. And this is where we have a lot of the what they call polders. So closer to the ocean or the sea is where they established windmills and pumped out a very complex series, kind of like we have the canal system through Ohio. They pumped out a series of drainage ditches and larger collection areas and pushed all that water back out. And so this part of the area is actually below sea level. So it's constantly at threat of flooding. And they maintain that through a lot of safety dams. And so there's a couple areas where you can still find significant quantities of windmills. And this is also probably where we'll see a lot of the grazing agriculture that's really well known over there. So you see all these land areas with those drainage ditches. They've taken all that water away and basically farmed right there where it used to be underwater. The area, the pictures on the right, that's the Kinderdijk area. And the Kinderdijk is down closer to Rotterdam. As we get down close to Rotterdam, there's a lot of industrial pieces that we want to see as well, and some historical things like the Dutch pottery, the Delft pottery in The Hague, which is, of course, where we have our world quartz. Let's see. Oh, yeah, cheese market. So there you get a great picture of me in 2008. And that cheese wheel, I think, is in the Ag Admin building, if you know where to look. So the picture on the left is not mine. It's actually from a tourist website, but that's one of the famous cheese markets over there, the Alkmaar. And we probably plan to stop at the Gouda one as well. If you think about Gouda cheese, there's a Gouda region. And potentially there's an Edam area that we could go to as well. So these markets are on different days and we'll try to stop in. The Alkmaar is maybe a little bit more touristy. You can kind of tell from maybe the costumes and the fanfare. And I think the opening picture on the slide set is also from the Alkmaar. The cheese is a big thing there. So I think Dr. Eastridge's advice to you if you're coming on this trip is to leave yourself some suitcase space. As he said, he would always take two suitcases, and the one suitcase he would make sure he was carrying gifts for the people that hosted us. And that way it was empty so he could bring cheese home. And I think that's probably going to be my strategy as well. I developed quite the taste for varieties of cheese while I'm over there. I'm looking forward to it because it'll probably never be more affordable than when you're there. And a lot of things that you might never try here in the store, you'll be willing to take a chance on over there. And just amazing to see all the cheese. Let's see what's next. Oh, Layli. So, you know, we're talking about getting Layli robots at Waterman. And one of the things I think it's always on the list for the trip over there is to see Layli. I think it'll even have more impact now for us than it maybe did in the past when you think about the installation of these, probably at the Waterman dairy farm in the next year or so. And actually, what I did not realize until I started doing some homework, I think about Layli from the standpoint of robotics, robotic feeders, robotic feed pushers, robotic milkers. I didn't realize how long the company had been established in some of this automation. And I also didn't realize how much of a hand the company has in many of the other pieces of equipment that we might be more familiar with on the farm. So I've got the hay rake up there, for example. That's a Layli hay rake. Pieces that I would not have expected to have associated in my head with Layli. And so actually they'll host us there and we'll take a pretty good tour of where they produce a lot of this equipment and learn some about their innovation as well. That's down in Rotterdam. So then, no, go ahead. And then, I had set these up as animations and then I apparently messed them up, but I would have challenged you to try to interpret what the heck that word is up at the top. So that would be pronounced Melkvee Bedrijven, but basically it means dairy farm. So, right, it's a dairy trip. And so these are farms where we're milking animals, but you can see dairy farms here in Ohio, or you can see dairy farms in Michigan, where I went to school. So instead, what we're going to try to do is show you some different production sites. So some organic dairies, goat dairies, there's a camel dairy that's on our list. There's actually a dairy that floats in the river in Rotterdam. And we'll try to get a tour on that as well. That's pretty new, where they take the manure and then have to haul it back off of that floating dock. And the cows actually will walk up and down the ramp. Ryan, I think if you advance it, I might have a couple more pictures. I just kind of screwed it up. Oh yeah. So that's just a picture, I guess, of a group out by pasture dairy. But there's a lot of, again, we associate the Netherlands with more sustainable agriculture and kind of the future of those practices. And so you're going to see a lot of rotational grazing. And even Lely, I think, has basically an automated pasture rotator that they use now to move animals around, because a lot of the labor in rotational grazing kind of prohibits its adaptation here in the U.S. So, and then we'll go up from there to my area where I spent some time in Wageningen and Utrecht. So historically, this is where the Germans surrendered. It's also where the Dutch surrendered in 1940, but where the Germans then surrendered as Allied forces were moving in. And that view there on the left is over the park where that occurred. And I threw the picture in the bottom right because I think it's easy to get lost in the itinerary. But I think the other piece, and Jess, I'm sure you'll agree, Ryan, the same, the people that you will get to know on this trip are really special. So the people in the picture on the bottom right, with the exception of one, I would pick on them, but this is going to go on YouTube. All of those people in that picture actually came back to my wedding. So we were housemates in the Netherlands for 4 months. We traveled everywhere together, developed some really close friendships with those folks, and friendships that still carry on to this day. Now it's, you know, by text message with the pandemic, but I'm looking forward to seeing them again 15, 20 years down the road. And so don't underestimate, you know, maybe this isn't the trip for you. Maybe you're interested in something else, but don't underestimate the value of doing a trip like this and taking a trip with some of your peers. And so I know Ryan was kind of joking about, well, we got Nicole, not to put you in the hot spot, but you're the one that sat in and attended here, right? But don't underestimate the value of actually recruiting your friends, because the people that you bring along with this will be part of what makes this experience so wonderful. I would encourage you to share this with anybody you think might be interested in coming along. You'll form some long-term bonds. I don't know, Jess or Ryan, you have any more to add on that?
No, ditto. And even though it's this isn't a 6-month trip or anything like that, it's a shorter excursion, but it's going to change your life. Absolutely. And even the people you meet abroad, we hope to bring you together with other students, in the Netherlands. So, I mean, I think those relationships too will last. You might not see them as often, but it's educational, but I think there's so much more that, you know, students get from this and us too. I mean, I still look back when I went, and I mean, it's crazy to think that I'm now taking students, but just if I hadn't, you know, I likely those experiences kind of led me to this position. So it, didn't do it while you can, because once you, you know, get out and have kids and start a career, it gets trickier to travel. So, yeah, it's just life-changing. I think it's a great way to sum it up then.
I think you captured a nice piece there, that you're never going to have a better chance to do this than you do right now. Sorry, Ryan, I cut in on you.
No, I was going to say, it sounds like you all have read the bullet points that we just market for any, you know, education abroad program. I mean, these are the things that we always talk about. And some of the best benefits of these faculty-led programs are the people and the relationships that you create. Even though it's shorter term, just like they both just mentioned, you know, these are students that are all making the same decision as you. You know, you are all taking that step together, and it's a shared experience, right, that no one else will ever have. You know, it'll never be the same as it was, and especially right now, talking about 2022 in this crazy world that we're living in, right? It'll never look the same as it does when you go with the people you go with. So there's something, I think, very valuable about that. And yeah, I mean, it's just, it's a pretty cool thing. And to hear Dr. Winter talk about that, I mean, just the folks in the photograph, right, that came back for his wedding. I mean, there's just so much truth to that, the people being the most impactful part of so many of these programs. So yeah, I would definitely encourage, and for the folks you already know that you're friends with here in the U.S., right, it's like a chance to take the friendship you already have and totally amplify it, right? You're doing something that is so different, you know, this shared experience. So just would reiterate all those points. I think that's a great way to look at it.
Yeah. So I was just going to chime in. I forgot while I was sitting here. The reason I had those two up there is those are actually two primary schools, ag schools there, and we do plan to set up time for you as students on this trip to interact with students there at Wageningen and Utrecht. So, you know, there will be the opportunity to spend, you know, half a day or so socializing and getting to know people from a different country. And I think there's a lot to be learned in appreciating their culture and their perspective and talking to them in a more casual environment instead of the, you know, day-to-day tours. So, and that is all I had.
Great. Well, now we're going to roll through maybe more of the boring side if that was the fun side. But these are the important pieces that you need to know, right, while you're looking at if this is a decision that, you know, you want to make or not. So first off, want to get the two big pieces here. The program fee is the thing that everybody always wants to know about, right? It's the most important question. How much is this going to cost, right, for me to be able to go abroad? We don't have it yet. That's why it says TBD up there on the screen. We should have it finalized prior, or hopefully by the end of December is what we're planning on, so that you have that number in mind when you go on to make your decision. Now, Nicole, since you're obviously, we're going to keep picking on you since you're the only one on the call. Have you been on the program's webpage yet on the website? Have you looked through any of that information? It's all right if you haven't. Okay, cool. I'm going to talk about that and where to find that information, because that is where everything you need to know is housed. Okay, it's on the program's webpage. And it's where it will be updated first once that, you know, the program fee is official. You'll see it there. The application deadline as of today is January 5th, 2022. There is a chance, just logistically, you know, if we don't have that program fee published by January 5th, we're not going to make you apply, right, without knowing how much it's going to cost. So there's a chance that that gets pushed back a little bit, you know, and maybe into mid-January. So something to keep in mind, if you're writing it down for now, go ahead and write down that January 5th deadline to keep in mind. But there is a real chance that that might get pushed back. It just depends on how quickly we hear back from our vendors and get an itinerary selected so that we can get a price published. Now, a couple things to keep in mind that we already know. In that program fee, your round trip airfare is going to be included on that. Okay, so that's not going to be a separate cost that you have to book for yourself out of pocket. The benefit of the airfare being included is if you have scholarships or financial aid that you were already looking to apply for this program, you can use your scholarships to pay for that airfare, because it's all going to be billed as essentially university tuition is what it'll look like. It'll be treated the same way. So that's the benefit of it being looped in on the program fee rather than you paying for that airfare out of pocket, you know, how you just book a flight, you know, if you were to just do it on your own. So I'll talk about that a little bit more in just a second. So this is what I was referencing before, right? Where do we find the information we need, right, to be able to make our decisions? The website is globaleducation.osu.edu. We just recently went through our third rebrand, I believe, in the last 10 years, as far as what we call this thing is, you know, sending students abroad. But yeah, the magic words are global education now. So if you go to globaleducation.osu.edu, you'll see a little search bar. It just says program search at the bottom of the page. And another fun thing about this program, if you just search the word dairy, there's only one program that comes up, because this is it. So just search the word dairy in that search bar. It'll pull up the program and you'll have, you know, kind of a brief overview of the points that we talked about. It's got the learning objectives on there, but there are tabs on that page. One is a general program overview. One is eligibility. So what are the eligibility requirements in order to be able to participate? One is academics. So what are the courses associated with the program? One is financial. That's where the program fee will be updated and the budget sheet will be displayed so that you'll see exactly what you're paying for and exactly what the out-of-pocket expenses are that you might need to keep in mind, right? There's stuff that folks maybe don't think about all the time, right? Maybe there's some meals that aren't included. Maybe you want to have a cell phone while you're abroad. You know, we put in all of those, you know, kind of optional expenses as well so that you can think about how much in total, you know, a trip like this would cost you. So all of that is available on the webpage 100%. And Nicole, I'm going to go back to it, right? If you are interested in this program at all, as of today, I would encourage you to go to the website and go ahead and start an application, just because there's no obligation at all, you know, for you to apply to the program. But if you have an application open, it flags you in my system to where, hey, I know Nicole is at least remotely interested in the program. We just published the program fee. I'm going to send her an email today so that she knows, you know, as soon as it's published. So definitely a benefit to go ahead and start. it works just like a Google Doc, you know, or anything like that, where you can, it saves your work as you go. So you can knock out, you know, some of those questions leading up to the deadline and have them out of the way while you're still on the fence about, you know, deciding whether to apply or not. There is absolutely no commitment at all until you actually hit submit and pay your $150 application fee. So I always encourage students, if you're even 1%, you know, interested in the program, just start an application so that you are getting the most, you know, up-to-date information as we get it. You know, I can get it to you as soon as we can. So yeah, and that's kind of what this says on this page, right? Just a pretty simple on how to apply. You're going to search for the program page. Once again, you just search dairy on the search bar. And then at the bottom of every page, every single one of those tabs, you'll see this little gray line, which is a button that says apply now. If you've never applied to a study abroad program before, it will bring you in with your Ohio State dot number. After you type that in, it'll prompt you to create your education abroad account. And then it's pretty straightforward from there. It walks you through how to fill your application out. So definitely would encourage you to start there if you're interested. Scholarships, kind of give the same spiel every time we do this. The most important scholarship that you need to make sure that you have applied for is this one here in the middle, CFAES scholarship, right? And if you go to Google, this is the way I always explain it, because this is how I find my information too. Go to Google and type in CFAES general scholarship. It'll be the first link that comes up, and you may have already submitted it, you know, for this year. It opened back in October, but you need to make sure you have this scholarship application on file so that we can, essentially, they take your application and send it out to hundreds of different scholarships to see what is available to you. Dr. Pat Whittington does a great job here in our academic programs office of linking up, you know, the correct scholarship to what's available to you. We give about $100,000 in education abroad scholarships out a year, you know, in a normal year, right? We haven't been able to give some funds out in a while. So the next time that we have programs running, there may be some additional funds that are even given out. The average amount that the college will give out is $1,000 as a scholarship award. And I think the minimum that we've seen is 500, but the range is 500 to 2000. So there's a real good chance. I think the last time we looked at the numbers, there's about a 50% chance if you're going abroad on a CFAES program and you're a CFAES student, you will get some sort of scholarship from the college. So I always want to start there, right? Because you want to put your time in where you have the best chance, right, to receive funds, especially if you're only going to fill out a couple. Always, always, always start there. And it's not only education abroad, right? I harp on it for us, but it also makes you available for the general scholarships that are available to you as a CFAES student. So 100% make sure that you, even if you don't apply for the program, okay, make sure that you get this, you know, scholarship form filled out. Outside of our college-specific scholarships, the Office of International Affairs has a long list of university-wide education abroad scholarships. This year, they've actually made it a little simpler, the process for it. There's one common scholarship application for the university-wide scholarship. So you only have to fill out one scholarship application. And it runs through the Global Education website. So the application for that is going to look really similar to your actual dairy sciences application. It's all hosted on the same website. So if you go to Office of International Affairs scholarships, Ohio State, it'll be the first link that comes up, and you'll just look under the undergraduate tab and click through any that you think might be applicable to you. The Gilman Scholarship is another one that we always want to advertise. It's available to any U.S. citizen with a Pell Grant as part of their financial aid package. And then the Gilman McCain is kind of a variation of that, is available to children of active duty military with Title IV funding, Title V funding. I'm bad with my Roman numerals. Or Title IX. And then the federal financial, sometimes you're able to apply your financial aid in order to participate for a global education Title IV funding. Thanks, Elizabeth. You're able to apply your financial aid package to help take care of this program fee. It just depends on what your financial aid package looks like and what, you know, your decisions are. Essentially just for what your personal situation is. Because since this is a summer program, you would need to take at least 6 credit hours over the summer in order for your financial aid to be available to you over the summer semester. And that can potentially impact how many total semesters you have of financial aid. So if financial aid is something that you're interested in helping to cover this program fee, just reach out to us and we'll get you connected to the right representative in the financial aid office. Thanks, Liz. COVID, right? That's like the big topic right now, and why everything that we say has an asterisk on it essentially right now. So I guess we'll start at the beginning. All Ohio State programs, right, must be approved by the OSU International Travel Policy Planning Committee, the ITPC, as they've come to be known as. These folks are looking at the country that we're visiting, right? What are their COVID rates? How are they doing with COVID? How is their medical system handling it? How much available medical care do they have, right? If we go to the country and you get sick with a non-COVID related illness or injury, are we still able to get you into a hospital, or are they, you know, overrun with how much they're already handling? These are things that they're looking at for every country that we're looking at. Now, that's health and safety is kind of one side. And then the other side is the logistical piece, right? If we're going to go to all the way to the Netherlands, we want to make sure that we're able to get into, right, the farms, the dairies, the manufacturing plants that we're wanting to visit, the universities, right, that we're wanting to visit, because we don't want to make the trip over there if we're not able to accomplish our learning objectives. So those are the kind of the two sides that that committee looks at. And then they will make these things that are called viability decisions, right? Got all the information listed here. That's kind of the initial green light, you know, red light or green light for the program to be able to go. So our date for the European Dairy Sciences program is January 31st is when they'll do the viability decision. So you're like, wow, Ryan, that's like a month after, right? The application deadline. Yes, it is, because we need to know if we have the students, right? In order for the program to run, because if we don't have the students, it doesn't really matter, right? Whether the program is, you know, safe to run to the country, because it's not going to go if we don't have enough students interested in it. So that decision will be made at the end of January. The important part of that to keep in mind is, and it's on this last slide, you have nothing to lose by applying, okay? Ohio State has put protections in place to where none of the financial burden of the program being canceled will fall onto you, okay? So we talk about that program fee, in the airline and the group flights and, you know, the booking of the hotels, all that. If Ohio State makes the decision to cancel the program, none of the financial obligation will fall on you. So that's like the reassuring thing to keep in mind. The thing, you know, the thing for you to think about would be, you know, is there an experience here in the US or a different experience that you might want to have in your back pocket as you're thinking about what your summer looks like, you know, whether, you know, there's an internship or, you know, some sort of work experience that you're wanting to have, you know, you just need to have some sort of a backup plan in case, just in case the program gets canceled, you know, because we don't want you to have all your eggs in this basket, right? And then the program's not able to travel. And that's kind of that last point on there, realistic expectations. Programs may be canceled, okay? We had 5 programs that we were planning for spring break out of the college, and all 5 of them were denied at the viability point of the decision. Now, that's a pessimistic, you know, thing, right? 0-5, not very good. The thing that we have benefiting us with this dairy program and the rest of the summer programs is time. And that's the only thing that's on our side, right? When we're trying to get out of this, as we're trying to get out of the pandemic where we are right now, is that because they're later in the summer, we're hoping, right, that by the time viability decisions are made at the end of January, even if we see, you know, global numbers go up, you know, in this month and even into mid-January, the trends have been that these next 2 months have been kind of the roughest time for COVID. We're hoping that by the time the end of January rolls around and they're making those projections into the summer, that hopefully we're able to get the green light to travel. So at the end of the day, this is just, you know, we want to be honest with you, right? Just as we're being honest with ourselves, is there, this is in no way 100% chance or 100% guarantee that the program is going to travel, right? It's just about having those realistic expectations as we go into it and knowing that financially you have nothing to lose by applying to the program, right? The only way you can guarantee yourself that you won't go to the Netherlands this summer is if you don't apply, you know, to the program. So just something we've been sharing with each of our summer programs. So next steps, right? pretty simple. Maybe you've thought about this already. Discuss it with your support system. So your friends, your family, your academic advisor. I'm going to underline that, your academic advisor, right? How does that fit into, yeah, she's waving. How does that fit into your, you know, your degree plan? Where will this credit fit in? How does it impact the other classes you'll be taking, you know, for the rest of your semesters here at school? Applying, once again, the dairy deadline is January 5th as of today. So make sure you have that circled on your calendar. Applying for scholarships, you can do that as early as today. Once again, the CFAS scholarship, it doesn't matter whether you are going on this program or not. Make sure you get the scholarship filled out. You know, you can do that once again as early as today. Applying for a passport. Nicole, do you have a passport? No, you do not. Why don't you just shoot me an email after today's presentation and I'll walk you through how we can get that application started. Whether you go on, this is just like the scholarship, whether you go on this program or not, I would encourage you just to at least learn about the passport application process. And I would encourage you to apply, right? Because right now we're seeing it's taken as long as it's ever taken, right? In recent history for passport processing times, they're expecting like 12 to 16 weeks after you submit your application. So for, you know, May, right, seems far off right now as things stand, but you really, by the time you get your passport back, you know, even if you file your application as soon as possible, it's still going to be a couple months, you know, before you get it back. And that's if everything goes through on the first try. So there's essentially, just like with anything with the government, right, there's a form you got to fill out. With the passport, there's sometimes one of the pieces that students don't know about is that you have to submit a picture with your passport application. And that picture is a pretty important part of the process. And those pictures actually do get denied if they're not, correctly taken and meet each of those requirements. So Nicole, just shoot me an email after this and I'll get you all set up. And that goes for anybody, that is watching this recording in the future. Just go ahead. And my email's here on the right side of this slide. Long goofy last name, vonderhaar.15@osu.edu. Just send me an email and I'll get you set up with your next steps in order to apply for a passport. And that goes for any questions. Elizabeth and I here in the Global Education Office, if you got anything related to the application process or this program, or if you want to learn about other programs, there's our emails here on the slide and you can just email us at any time. We're happy to meet with you and talk to you really about anything. And with that, open it up to questions. Nicole, we've picked on you enough. If you don't have any questions, that's okay. But yeah, we got all kinds of time if you do have anything. That's all right. You don't have to.
Hey, Ryan, I would just comment, as of today, we are able to get in the country. So that is at least positive.
Yes.
You know, when you think about viability, I think traditionally this program went across multiple countries. And we dialed it in and stayed in the Netherlands to try to improve the odds that we would be able to go. And the Netherlands are the most accepting and have a pretty clear, transparent process for how we can document vaccination status and get into the country.
That's a great point. Yeah. Sometimes I don't want to come off as too pessimistic on the COVID slide, but it's just been like, you know, we want to make sure everybody's on the same page as far as expectations. There's a real chance that it isn't able to run, but we're doing everything in our power, you know, to get this program to travel. So, and that's a great point Dr. Winter brings up, is this program initially did travel to Belgium and Netherlands. This year, we've switched it just to a single country to help accommodate some of those risk management / travel policy issues we're trying to work around. So great point. Nicole, if you don't have any other questions, we don't, it's okay.
Yeah, just one. So you said that if there weren't enough people that signed up and applied, the program wouldn't work. Is there like a certain amount that you're expecting you need to have?
Yep, we need to have at least 10 students. That's the easy answer. So if you can get a couple friends, we'll be halfway there.
There's at least 4 right now enrolled in the course.
Okay.
So I don't know if that necessarily translates to going abroad, but at least that's a start.
And we, just because things have been taking so long, especially with the program fee, you know, we're a little behind as far as recruitment goes, but you know, some of this has just been, things are taking longer. I mean, it's not just this program. It's essentially all of our summer programs. So more information to come.
You're being nice not to throw us under the bus. I know that I held us up on the itinerary. So
that was not what I meant at all. That's not true.
I'm very guilty as well then. I don't know what to put in here yet. Google. No.
We will have an itinerary done and a program fee published here at the end of December/early January, and you'll have all the information you need to make your decision. Definitely. Yeah. Great. Well, with that, Dr. Pimpak or Dr. Winter, anything else to share? It's all right if we want to wrap up.
No, thanks for joining, and for future viewers, thanks for watching. And I, if this isn't the trip for you, that doesn't hurt my feelings. I want you to want to go, but I do encourage everybody to go somewhere.
Yeah.
And that is my big push.
I agree with that too. And I think sometimes when we think dairy, we're like, oh, cows. But just remember, it's not just about cows. We're, you know, looking at this from every species. So yeah, it's going to be a great experience. We want you to come on this trip with us, but like Dr. Winter said, if this isn't the one, then still connect with Ryan and we'll find you the one. But
definitely
join us.
Love it.